So, good morning, one and all. Thanks for attending this important session because today we are going to cover the difference and similarities between ISO 9001 and ISO 13485. So, those who do not know the full form of ISO, ISO is an international standards of organization, and we have applied for the two standard certification, that is ISO 9001 and ISO 13485. So all the contents are taken from the internet and the sources are acknowledged, and you will find all the content available when you buy a standard, that is ISO 9001 and ISO 13485. So whenever you apply for any certification through notified body, you have to purchase those standard. If it is available freely, you can refer to. But I would request you to purchase those standard. So with the change of ISO 9001 to the new high level structure, the content of the two standards have diverged. So if you see ISO 9000 standards are using from several decades. And there are a couple of changes happening in those standards as per the high level structure. And we are not going to discuss other standards, though there are thousands of standards available. But we are going to cover only two standards because those are important to our company. So, and what is the diversity, how it is organized, what are the different clauses defined by the in these two standards that we are going to discuss. So, while this divergence may cause some concern in the organization where both standards are relevant, the knowledge of the difference and similarities will hopefully help you better understand how your organization may react to these new revisions and mitigate this concern. Because ISO 9001 earlier standard was 2003, then it had changed to 2005, then 2015 is the current standard. So whenever we want to refer, you have to refer to the current standard. So there is a history behind for each standard, and you will find that history on the internet. But at the same time, some companies apply for both standard together and they want to integrate the system. So that is also fine if you are able to integrate the system and you successfully cover all the clauses and try to explain and build the effectively quality management system, that is also acceptable. But how you capture all the differences in your quality manual, that depends on your skill set. Because some people, they focus on one standard when they apply for particular generic, as a generic standard for ISO 9001. And some people would like to go for together. Suppose if you are into medical device industry, then ISO 13485 becomes mandatory standard. So you have to really think about while applying for these standards, for what reason you are applying, and how these standards will be implemented in our company successfully, how the people will be trained. That is very important, because all the processes, management, and everything depends on your company's decision. So top management, the leadership plays a very important role for the, deciding which standard to apply, how it has to be applied, how it has to be controlled, all the processes to be implemented, and the interlink between the all clauses, that becomes very important part when we talk about the standard. So again, I'm telling, it is the similarities that are more prevalent and the value in those, these two standards can be used together. That will provide industry with the greatest insight and the corresponding strategic direction. The main differences between these two standards is ISO 9001:2015 has 10 clauses, whereas ISO 13485:2016 has 8 clauses. So when we design a manual, please keep in mind all the applicable regulatory requirement behind these clauses. So while there are several differences in the terminology and the structure, there are no direct conflicts between the requirement of these two standards. And ISO 9001:2015 and ISO 13485:2016 can work together to outline the quality management system for organization concerned with providing products within the supply chain of medical devices. So I hope you understood the basic differences that ISO 9001 has 10 clauses and 13485 has 8 clauses, but how they interlink with each other, that is shown in the next slide. So before moving forward, I would like to show what is the changes as compared to ISO 9001:2008 to 9001:2015, which is the current standard, and the old one is ISO 9001:2008. So what has not changed or unchanged? The scope, normative references, and terms and definition. You will see after 2008 till 2015, these three clauses remains the same. But when we talk about the fourth clause, that is quality management system, has changed to the context of organization. Then the fifth clause, that is management responsibility, it has broken down into leadership and planning. Then resource management is support. Now the new terminology is adopted, that is support. The product realization, it is operation. And the measurement analysis and improvement, it is converted to performance evaluation and the improvement. Improvement means continuous improvement. So this is the, changes happened from 2008 version to 2015. So these are the main clauses when we talk about ISO 9001:2015. Right from the first clause, that is scope. Second, normative references, terms and definition, context of organization, leadership, planning, support, operation, performance evaluation, and improvement. So these are the 10 clauses you have to remember when we go for ISO 9001 certification. So the clause-wise differences, you will find these also on internet. The clause one talks about the scope, which exclude product realization requirements that are not within the context of the organization. And the clause two talks about the normative references, which identify the reference standards or publication relevant to the particular standard. Clause three talks about the terms and definitions which are applicable to this standard. Clause four talks about the context of the organization. This clause is very important when we talk about the internal and external issues, as well as interested parties who will guide you the organization, and this is under QMS scope. Clause five, again, leadership. So top management, again, is extremely important factor in both the standards, I would say 13485 and 9001. So top management provides leadership and direction for the organization by accepting and defining roles and responsibilities with an emphasis on quality and customer satisfaction. Clause six talks about the planning. Again, planning, it is, we have to always think about the risk-based approach. So risk and opportunity should be considered when planning and the changing of the quality management system. Clause seven talks about the support. So support are these things like which makes the quality management system possible. Such as, see, support is we are getting from people, the facilities, the equipment. So how good support we can be provided with respect to people, facilities, and equipment, we have to discuss under clause 7. Clause 8 talks about the operation, like development development of product, then implementation, then control of processes. It talks about product and process both. So generally operation covers the processes. So when you develop your process, implement, control, how you develop, how you implement, how you control, It is necessary to provide products and services while managing risk and opportunities. Again, risk-based approach is very important. So you have to develop your risk management plan. You have to identify the risk, then how you mitigate the risk, how you make the change control system, CAPA, everything becomes very important. Then come to clause 9, that is performance evaluation. You have to monitor, measure, analyze, and evaluate the effectiveness and efficacy of the quality management processes. Then the improvement, which identify opportunities to improve processes, products, services to enhance customer satisfaction. So improvement would be always, there should be a continual improvement. So you, this chart is very popular. It is called PDCA cycle. PDCA means plan, do, check, and act. So when it is a stage of plan, you have to, you know, club those clauses under this PDCA cycle, and you have to implement accordingly. So when you talk about the PDCA cycle, under plan, you have to capture, you know, the context of the organization, issues for the, you know, internal, external sources, then processes, then you have to maintain quality objectives. So quality objectives is very important, and it has to be defined department-wise, person-wise. The quality objective should be measurable, you know. So quantification to be done, and everything comes under this plan, the clause of planning. And when we plan, the leadership plays an important role. So top management leadership plays, not only during planning, so they have to monitor also when you do, act, and check. So after plan, when you come forward with the doing activity, then support, operational control, design, productions are the relevant clauses. Then under check, management review, internal audit, performance evaluation. So you know, every quarter there is a management review, so it has to be defined in your SOP. How the MRM is carried out in your company, how frequently the internal audit has to be conducted, how it has to be conducted, then you have to evaluate the performance, like KPI and all the self-development program, the training matrix, the competency matrix. These all things are important when we talk about PDCA cycle. Act means, suppose if you find any non-conformities in your system, in your processes, or anything like document, system, processes, or any other area, then you have to take the corrective action. So corrective action, preventive action is again very important. And not only preventive action, you see to that it doesn't occur. So reoccurrence has to be avoided. That means there is a continuous improvement, and you have to monitor how it is continually improving, whether it is system, process, people. So how this PDCA cycle is applicable in any company, that we have to see. And top management is always responsible along with other people working in your company. So please try to remember this PDCA cycle forever, because you are going to go for the first stage audit maybe next week. So please prepare in the, you know, with the context of organization and other clauses which are important, and we have defined in our quality manual as well, and we have made several SOPs. You know, there are so many SOPs, work instructions, then documents, record, technical file we have prepared to make the quality manual. So if you see the difference between ISO 9001 2015 and ISO 13485 2016, you can see the clause structure here. So here clause 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, with respect to ISO 9001, how it has to be, you know, integrated, that is shown in this slide particularly. So if you go for clause 4 of ISO 9001 and ISO 13485, it talks about the context of organization, which is similar to your quality management system. When we talk about leadership and planning, here they have termed as management responsibility. So left-hand side, I'm just describing about ISO 9001 and right-hand side, ISO 13485. So you can just, see the differences between these clauses and how it is applicable as per the regulatory requirement. So coming to seventh clause, that is support. Support means, as I mentioned earlier, support is provided by people, right? The infrastructure people. So here we have to talk about same in the different terminology, that is resource management. Operation, that is product realization. So whatever output is given, that is under operation only. So we have a production department who is operating and giving some output, right? So that is product realization, the final output. And then the ninth clause is performance evaluation and the improvement. So 9 and 10, when we talk about ISO 13485, it talks about measurement, analysis, and improvement. So in this way, many people goes together for both the standard and they integrate into manual. When we prepare the quality manual, we have to follow this pyramid. So this pyramid structure, again, how it has to be read. So there will be always a quality manual for, you can make one quality manual or a separate quality manual for both the standard. But I always prefer to have separate standard or the quality manual based on our scope. So for what scope we have applied for the certification. So when we talk about the quality manual will be one for one standard. Or it is one for two to three standard. I have seen the three standards are clubbed in one quality manual, like ISO 9001, ISO 13485, ISO 14000 also. But you should be in a position to, integrate it properly and make the relevant documents as per applicable regulatory requirement. So here, if you follow the pyramid, when we talk about manual is always on the top, because manual is one, but policy, procedure, as you go down and down and down, there will be the number and the size increases. Am I right? So procedures, there are lots of procedures to be written. You have seen in our case also, we have written more than 48 SOP standard operating procedures, right? There are so many work instructions. So apart from your procedures, the work instructions are more, in the company, because work instructions specifies with the pictorial diagram that how to work, on daily basis. Suppose if you are into production, so you have to make a nice flow chart with the pictorial diagram and display that work instruction in front of the machine. Say, for example, our operation is on machine. So that machine should display the work instruction, how it should be operated. Suppose the first step is switch on the button. So you have to write down the simple work instruction, switch on the machine, or maybe clean the machine, switch on the machine, and then the next step, whatever is applicable to your product. So all the work instruction depends on the actual process, the exact process being followed in your company and exact procedure followed to that particular machine. So suppose in a company, I have seen there are 300, 400 machines. So those many work instruction has to be prepared. So that is why the ratio is defined as per your own organization. When we talk about there are 50 SOPs, then work instruction could be, three times more than, it depends how many machines you have and, how many operations you have. So there are number of operations are limited, like all machines are placed in one department only, but the all machines are different. Then there are chances to have more and more work instructions. Then comes to record. So now you must have realized how many SOP, how many procedure, how many work instruction, if you are prepared, those many records also you have to maintain. So simple, I will give example of records. That is, one record is when you start your job, like when you enter into the factory, the entry exit becomes your record, right? So some people follow entering their name into register, some people follow biometric system, some people follow the swiping, the swipe cards. So there are several systems followed in different organizations. So depending on your company system, you have to follow and make the record. Now, when you enter, there is a governing system, right? So in some factories, I have seen they give the gown, the apron, the shoe cover, the head cover, hand gloves, or a full suit, you know? So they enter into the change room, and they change their street cloth to the factory cloth, and they enter into the production area or whichever area they are assigned, job assigned. So like that, see, all this becomes a record. Now, coming to work environment, when you enter into your premises, the work environment, whether the floor is cleaning, hygiene, cleanliness is maintained, so you have to keep one chart, right? The housekeeping people have cleaned this room today. So check the weather chart is placed. Today's date it was cleaned, at what time cleaned. Some production area I have seen every 2 hours the floor has to be cleaned, the hygiene to be maintained, the windows, the HO system to be properly maintained. In some cases the temperature, humidity has to be maintained. So all this becomes a record. So now you can imagine why the record is down the pyramid, because there are huge, huge record to be maintained for each and every person, each and every process, each and every product. So now you can imagine and, you know, you visualize how this pyramid is, you know, you, and accordingly you have to implement your quality management system in your company. I hope it is pretty clear now. Now let us walk through the difference and the similarities between these two standards. So let us talk about structure first. So ISO 13485 2016 continues with the structure developed in the previous version. Okay, and the ISO 9001 2015 uses the new structure specified in Annex structure level of the ISO IEC Directives Part 1. And this new high-level structure was developed by ISO to implement a common structure and terminology with simplified language to help organizations that are implementing multiple management systems, such as those of environment, health and safety, or business continuity, to integrate those systems. While this difference may cause some difficulties, most organizations that have a connection to the medical device sector will appreciate the continued consistency of the structure of ISO 13485, especially as the difference in structure has little effect on the requirements of those two standards. So what is the scope? The scope of ISO 9001 defines it as a general and generic standard for all quality management systems. So here I have to say that this ISO 9001 standard is applicable for any type of manufacturer or any type of company. Like suppose today I have my institution, tomorrow I'm manufacturing of some plastic items, or like I have changed from plastic to garment, or maybe somebody is going for the some other kind of business. So here what I mean to say exactly, the ISO 9001 defines as a general and generic standard for all quality management. So whenever you want to implement a quality management system in any kind of business, this standard is applicable. Okay, so this major difference you have to remember. ISO 9001 is a generic standard, and you can apply any kind of business wherever you want to design your quality management system. Whereas ISO 13485 is a specific and mandatory standards for the medical devices. So this standard, the ISO 13485 2016, is aimed at including those quality management system requirement for organization that provide medical devices and helping organization concerned with medical devices ensure that they meet not only the customer requirement, but also applicable regulatory requirements for the countries and the regions where the medical devices are provided. So I hope you understood the difference clearly, why we are going forward with the ISO 13485 2016, because we are going to register our medical devices in India, US or Europe as per the applicable regulatory requirement. And it is a mandatory standard when we talk about medical devices. And the focus, the general nature of and the industry that use ISO 9001 are driven by a customer focus and making correct risk-based decisions to minimize the risk of customer dissatisfaction. So, as I said, ISO 9001 is a generic standard and it is generally used or the widely used in any kind of business. And that is where customer satisfaction becomes a very important factor in this case. And we have to, you know, see that how you can satisfy your customer, how you, suppose if the customer feedback is not good, how you attend those customer queries or how customer complaint and how you raise the CAPA and, you know, how you open and close and how you take the preventive action so that there will be, there will be minimum dissatisfaction from the customer. So this is a general nature and of the industry that use ISO 9001, which is driven by the customer focus. Whereas the focus of ISO 13485 is primarily driven by the need for the regulators. Here, this is very important. Need for the regulators to ensure that the medical devices placed on the market by organization are safe and effective. Why we have to look into the safety and effectivity, the effective and the quality of the medical devices? Because medical devices used by the patient like us, by the human being, and it is a prime responsibility of any manufacturer or any regulator to keep track or to keep watch or to be vigilant about the quality, safety, and efficacy. And that is why whenever we want to start our business into medical devices or, you know, the supply chain that choose certification to go standard, we have to go for think about the quality, safety, and the efficacy of the product. Then we talk about the required processes. ISO 13485 2016 maintains the requirement to document key processes and the related documentation in a quality manual and other processes. Whereas ISO 9001 has taken a distinctly more flexible approach of allowing an organization to determine the documented information required to be maintained to ensure consistent result without directly stating the required documented information. Then personal identification. The flexibility of ISO 9001 allows top management to assign responsibilities and authorities without defining any required role. So here what I mean to say, here we need not to go for selecting MR, that is management representative, in case of 9001. So the top management, he can assign to anyone this kind of responsibility without defining any roles. Whereas for ISO 13485, defining or the taking responsibilities of MR is very important. And so we have to specifically identify the suitable person who is competent enough to carry out all those responsibilities and so that MR is retained. So this is a mandatory requirement of MR in 13485. Then the product realization. 134852016 continues a strong emphasis on design and development as a key process within product realization. So as you might have heard about the story about Johnson & Johnson hip plant and many other devices who has, affected the health of the people because of the design failure. So design history, design file, design development becomes a very important when we talk about product realization. And in case of like medical devices, class one, like us, we are going for class one or class two product, wherein the risk is very less, minimal. And that is why we have excluded this design and development clause from our quality manual, wherein we are able to justify, because we are just adapting the customer specific design and the requirement, the customer specific as per the customer specific requirement, we are going to manufacture our product. And that is why design and development clause is not applicable in our case. But wherever it is applicable, you have to maintain those file perfectly, right from design input, design output, design verification, validation, the design transfer. So these all things are very, very important when we talk about ISO 13485. And when ISO 9001, this shifts this emphasis to the identification of operational processes to deliver product. And this slight change encourages organization to be more focused on their operations to get products or services to meet the customer needs rather than the documentation of the design and development of the product. So here you can clearly see that when we talk about or emphasize on design and development, many, many documents are involved. Whereas 9001, if we consider, they emphasize on the identification of operational processes and to deliver the product, the final product. And that is why, you know, we get the liberty of making minimal documents and we have to focus on the customer satisfaction, customer needs, you know, rather than those documentation of design and development. Then when we talk about continual improvement, 9001 continues an emphasis on continual improvement to both enhance customer satisfaction and improve the processes of the organization. So in both case, like, you know, the continual improvement is must, and how you attend, it depends how you make your system robust to attend those all complaints, how you make the CAPA, how you close those CAPA and take the preventive action has to be defined in the quality manual and has to be implemented. Not only it should be the written instruction, you have to maintain all the records, how you attend, how you attend the complaint, how you raise the CAPA and close the CAPA. When we talk about ISO 13485, it maintains the need for organization to focus improvement activities on the continuing suitability, adequacy, and effectiveness of quality management system and the safety and performance of the medical devices. And these differences drive the differing focus and could cause the organization goals to be slightly different. Then we talk about the terminologies used in both the standards. So ISO 9001:2015 has added the risk-based thinking directly into the plan, do, check, act, PDCA concept. And this has resulted in a new diagram of process in the 9001, and the new structure has also resulted in an update to the process approach model. So by incorporating risk-based thinking in this area, the application automatically integrates preventive action into all processes as the organization is required to take action to reduce within the process and prevent occurrence of any potential non-conformities through the continual improvement. So we have discussed this PDCA cycle, how it helps. We have discussed the risk management, right? So we will be discussing in the next session about the risk management completely, you know, right from how to you know, identify the risk in your processes, in your product, and how you work around that risk, you know, how you make your risk management plan, how you how to identify, how to mitigate, and how that plan, you know, becomes very effective when we implement our quality management system in company will be discussed during the risk assessment process and the training session. But just remember that in both the standard, we have to think about risk-based approach, because your quality manual or your quality management system become effective or shows the effectiveness when we start thinking from the risk, you know, risk-based thinking. So we have to, you know, think about not only the product, the risk involved in the product, the people, right from the, you know, raw material received in your factory till how it is utilized, how it is manufactured, and the output, the final product is dispatched to the customer. So all right from, you know, you have to identify the risk right from the raw material ordered, the first, till the final product dispatched to the customer. And not only after dispatching, how you receive the feedback, then if you register the product, when your product is recalled from the, you know, regulatory authority, then only you have to see that how the pharmacovigilance system is maintained, how you take care of those recall. So in this way, we have to, you know, build a strong structure of quality management system, wherein we can showcase ourselves that yes, we are continuously thinking and taking care of risk-based approach. And then the required documentation, this terminology is how it is used, required documentation. So in ISO 9001, the terminology used for the documentation had changed to documented information. So this is one change which I have to specify the difference between ISO 9001. They use the term as documented information, whereas in ISO 13485, they use documentation include documents and records. So here you can see the documents and records have increased tremendously because of the quality, safety, and efficacy parameters as per the applicable regulatory requirement. Then the relationship, that is traditionally within a quality management system, relationship are identified between the organization and its customer and the organization and its suppliers. So as I said, the relationship also very important when we talk about the customer, organization, supplier. And this relationship have identified with the more generic term as interested parties. So when we talk about ISO 9001, you have to say the external and internal sources and all the interested party. You have to make a nice table, you know, how they interact with each other and how the our system is very effective. When we, you know, add the chart properly with the responsibilities, you know, the authorities and about every person involved in our organization, the internal customer or external customer. So then ISO 13485 2016 retains the previous terms to identify these roles consistently with the way they are designated in many of the medical device sector regulation. Then next terminology is the purchasing. So ISO 13485 2016 retains the subclause on purchasing with some clarification on supplier evaluation and selection and monitoring. Whereas ISO 9001:2015 changes the identification of these processes and associated controls to the use of externally provided processes products and services. That is, you can see the clause number 7.4 in 13485 and clause number 8.4. So how it is correlated with this clause. So this change of language may allow a more generic look at who the organization considers to be its supplier. Then terminology top management, that is the identification of top management within ISO 9001 has led to a change in the name of clause 5 from management to leadership to outline the roles of this important group. So this change will likely put greater emphasis on the need for leadership engagement in the management of requirement. And ISO 13485 keeps much of the previous language with some updates to the content of management reviews. You can see management representative is mandatory and management reviews how you implement in the system. It's equally important when we talk about ISO 13485. Then there are some definition, the terms like complaint, product and risk are different in two standards. And ISO 13485 has aligned the definition with those provided by the Global Harmonization Task Force, that is GHTF, and the regulatory requirement. So here I will give some time to read this chart for you. So you just see the comparison between this ISO 9001:2015 along with ISO 13485:2016. So how this clause wise, there is a similarity and the differences, you can just read. So you can see that 7.1.4 clause talks about the environment for operation processes, which is similar in ISO 13485, but the clause number is 6.4 about work environment and the contamination control. When 7.5.3 talks about control of documented information, so here in medical device 13485, we have to give the medical device file, then control of document, control of records, design and development files. So in this slide, you can see the correlation between the clauses defined under ISO 9001 and ISO 13485. This again 8.3.4 talks about design and development controls. Here 7.3.5, 7.3.6, 3.7, 3.8 talks about design development review, verification, validation, and design transfer. Then 8.5.5 post-delivery activities, whereas here you can see 13485 talks about right from 7.5.1, 5.3, 4, 8.22. So control of production and service provision, installation activities, service activities, complaint handling, reporting to regulatory authorities, action in response to non-conformity product after delivery. So the all these, SOP, all these work instruction to be in place. Whereas you see lots of documents and records are required when you implement ISO 13485. Then coming to 9.1.2, that is customer satisfaction. This is extremely important clause when we talk about ISO 9001. And same is emphasis given under 13485 also, wherein we talk about the communication, feedback, complaint handling, which ultimately aids to the customer satisfaction. Then 10.2 talks about non-conformity and the corrective action in 9001, whereas here in 13485, we talk about control of non-conformity product corrective action under clause 8. Then there are some clauses which are not equivalent. Those are like cleanliness of products. Then you can see, sorry, cleanliness of products, particular requirement of sterile medical device, particular requirement of validation processes, and so on. So I hope you understood it clearly, the differences so far. So now, the differences between ISO 9001 2015 and ISO 13485. So now we talk about the similarities. We have seen the differences between two standards. Now we see what are the similarities quickly. So while two standards have some divergence in structure and terminology, they have several similarities that allow them to work together without conflict. This should allow organizations who have or are looking to obtain ISO certification for 9001 and to also obtain and maintain certification for ISO 13485. So reason for using this both standard continue to emphasize that adoption of the quality management system is a strategic decision for the organization. So a management in any organization that decides to use a quality management system should integrate the requirement of this standard into their strategic planning and ensure the quality objectives are also aligned with the achievement of those organizational objectives. So we have done all this exercise, right? We have defined the quality objective of each department, and we ensured that those are measurable quality objectives. We have made the KPIs also. So these are some similarities which we have to follow for both the standards. Then the role of organization, both revised standard have outlined the need for the organization to determine their role or the purpose of in the supply chain of delivering a product to the customer. And this allows relevant people like interested parties, whether it is external or internal, to understand the scope of the organization and to determine the applicable requirement of the standard that apply to the organization. Then the customer focus. So both revised standards start the product realization process with determining customer need to drive the requirement for the organization products or services. While there is a small difference between how it is measured, so ISO 9001-6 customer satisfaction and ISO 13485 ask organization to demonstrate that customer requirements have been met. So this is a small difference between these two standards when we talk about the customer focus. But in both cases, customer focus is very important. Here we have to demonstrate, and there in 9001, we seek the customer satisfaction. So that is the main difference. And this minor difference is still the motivation for the organization to focus on the needs of the customer. Then when we talk about the methodology, both revised standards have maintained the use of process approach with the PDCA cycle as the core methodology that follows from the quality principles outlined in ISO 9000. And the risk-based, so both standards have the risk-based approach. Both revised standards advocate the use of risk assessment as the basis of making decision and the application of risk management to quality management processes. ISO 9001-2015 takes this a step further by integrating risk-based thinking as a key concept within the process approach and eliminating the separate subclause on the preventive action. Then competency. The updates to each of these standards has reflected a shift from the identification of training needs to ensure the competency of employees. This is again very important, because we have to see the employees who are hired are competent enough to take care of all their jobs assigned to them. And this is likely to result in organization having to determine a way to show that their employees are able to do the job they are assigned. And we have to maintain the competency skill matrix of each employee whenever we hire an employee, along with the appointment letter and when they are trained, like induction program should be in place, on-job training skill program should be in place, and every quarter or every, as per your company policy, you have to evaluate his competency matrix. Because when he joined, he could be at zero level. But when it is trained, when he has experience, he can reach up to from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, whereas he doesn't need any supervision, you know. So training and the competency matrix is extremely important in both the standards. Then when we talk about the infrastructure, so both revised standards have a renewed emphasis on the determination of the necessary building, equipment, and other resources, including information technology, that is IT, and that are needed for the processes and for ensuring your product conformity. And this is further emphasized in ISO 13485 that with regard to cleanliness of the environment and contamination control required in assembly or packaging of the product. So you can see infrastructure, it starts from your gate, right? Your design, layout, the work environment, whether your offices are air conditioned or normal room temperature is there. All the your building factory, do you have pest control in place? All the equipment are qualified. All the machinery used for the measuring or the testing purpose are calibrated or not. So all these factors become important when we talk about infrastructure. And again, the information technology. Now you must have seen all people are using advanced technology to get the more productivity. So when we talk about advanced technology, the advanced machinery or advanced equipment, which has computerized system, we generally purchase and you know start using it. But see to that when we purchase any equipment, which has computerized system has to be validated. So see to that your PCB or the computerized system, or suppose if you are using ERP or any system which has the electronic part, then see to that you get the 21 CFR Part 11 compliance certificate from your vendor. So this is very important when we talk about IT part, the information technology part, electronic part, or computerized system. So see to that computerized system is validated. So CSV becomes very important when we go for the automated system. So you have to see the ISP standard, that is GAMP. GAMP is a good automated manufacturing practices. And you have to follow those good automated manufacturing processes as defined by the applicable regulatory requirement. So when we are talking about the USFDA requirement, we have to follow 21 CFR Part 820, that is QSR, the quality system requirement, which is defined as per the CFR, Code of Federal Regulation 820. So I hope you understood the basic concept by using these two standards or by implementing two quality management system in our company. So again, the cleanliness, environment, how you monitor the temperature, humidity, how you protect your product from the contamination control, and how you like store your product, whether the cross-contamination is avoided, the contamination doesn't happen due to product cleanliness, or sometimes what happens, it may contaminated due to disease also. So apart from pest control is done to protect from the insect, rodent, and other animals. Whereas there is a contamination control from human being also. That's the reason medical checkup is very important. So you have to see that all employees working in medical device factory are healthy. They are free from any disease. So basic test has to be performed. The medical records has to be maintained. Why it is important now during COVID also you have seen when the person is infected with COVID, as a COVID positive, then it becomes harmful for other people also. And that's why this medical checkup, the medical report becomes mandatory when we work in the medical device or the pharma or any other industry. And apart from the quality, safety, efficacy parameters, the human working in the company has to be very healthy, very safe. So I think this clarifies about both the standards, how we have to ensure that all the processes, people, who are involved in the productivity have to be safe. Then the analysis of data. Another key concept emphasized in both revised standard is the need to use the appropriate statistical technique in data analysis to drive the action of the organization. So now years and years you are manufacturing batches, the data is analyzed, trained analysis is done. And there are lots of changes also happening in the product or processes. And to see that continual improvement is well managed. So when we generate lots of data, see to that the statistical evaluation of that data is to be performed. So many people now, using statistical tools to analyze their data. When we progress, when we, go to the higher level, it is always advisable to have statistical data analysis of your product, of your processes, so that it becomes easy. Suppose if you don't have any statistical tool, you can simply put up your data by using Excel sheet, the bar chart or the different types of chart, pie chart, bar chart, or you can use any tool wherein you can represent your data analysis very nicely. That has added advantage. So these techniques can be used to analyze your data, what I mean to say here. So to summarize, an organization seek to make strategic decision on the implementation of a quality management system, they need to understand how the similarities and differences between ISO 9001 and ISO 13485 can affect those decisions. And top management of organizations should seek to recognize how each of these two revised standards can work separately or together within their quality management system to achieve the goals and objective of their organization. And these are the references from where I brought together the content. And thank you very much for your kind attention. And this is, I hope you understood the similarities and the difference between ISO 9001:2015 and ISO 13485. Thanks once again. And if you have any question, now we will open for the question answer session for 5-10 minutes. And then we move towards the next session, that is auditing technique. Thank you once again.